All living substance is united and shares the same destiny. All people, those we love and those we do not, are united and share the same destiny. Birth to death, we share this unity with the sun, the earth, our kindred, strangers. Flowers in the field, the snow from the sky, birth, life, death, unknown, known, unknown. May we have the faith to accept this mystery and build upon it an everlasting truth and hope. Words from David Eaton, colleague and friend, as we begin our worship this morning. The mystery is always present, and we sing to it. We sing to it in voice and in song. Certainly use a rose in the winter time today, couldn't we? So let's create one with our hearts and our minds and our voices as we sing together, which is the sacrament that brings us together as a community, number 331. Life is the greatest gift of all. Shall we sing together? I invite you now to share with one another and with me the responsive invocation printed in your order of worship. I am for keeping the thing going while things are stirring. Because if we wait till it is still, it will take a great while to get it going again. Life is a hard battle anyway. If we laugh and sing a little as we fight the good fight of freedom, it makes it all go easier. I will not allow my life's light to be determined by the darkness around me. There's some powerful words right there. But other powerful words are coming your way just this moment from Patrick Eaman, member of the board of our governing board, member of the choir, and a really great guy. Let him talk to you for a minute.
Good morning and welcome to Fountain Street Church. Thank you, choir. The first rule being in the choir is don't lose your music. Welcome to the church that has received our city in times of joy and sorrow for over 100 years. So many voices of that history were guests from the community, stepped into our church and joined this church as part of their personal journeys of faith. And I was one of those people. I started in the choir in 1987 after a history of Episcopalian sermons, and have enjoyed it ever since. In a recent service, we were reminded that there is a season for all things. And so yesterday, your governing board spent a day in retreat to consider the many things that lay ahead, which is normal and seasonal, along with a little snow. But at this time, over the next year, we're looking closely and organizing on your behalf for two significant things. One is the soon-to-come retirement of Reverend Fred, and the other is a commemoration of 150 years of presence and service to this community with this church. And so my interest being here today as part of the governing board is that one of my additional duties is to seek and help guide others from our church into roles of leadership. So you may receive a call from me over the next year. You're welcome to contact me or any member of the governing board, but we seek many people that can help guide our choices, decisions, and commitment to find a new minister for our community in the weeks and months ahead. So I look forward to seeing you in many times, many gatherings over the next year. And if you find all of this interesting, you belong here. Welcome to Fountain Street.
Thank you.
readings, words created sometime in the past, often so far away we don't know who wrote them. Sometimes far away, but we do know who wrote them, that endure because they still capture something of value, meaning, challenge, comfort, who knows? This year I have focused and will continue to focus my efforts on finding things in that most ancient book of poetry in the Christian and Jewish tradition known as the Psalms. And in my walk through that volume, which I will not complete, I can assure you, I've reached Psalm 24, a psalm of David. The earth is Adonai's and all that it holds, the world and its inhabitants, who founded it upon the ocean, set it upon the high on the nether streams. Who may ascend the mountain of Adonai? Who may stand in that holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not taken a false oath on my existence or sworn deceitfully. That one shall carry away the blessing from Adonai, a just reward from God the deliverer. Such is the company of those who turn to God, the God of Jacob, and who seek your presence. Selah. O gates, lift up your heads. Up high, you everlasting doors, the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? Adonai, mighty and valiant. Adonai, valiant in battle. O gates, lift up your heads, lift them up, you everlasting doors, so the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? Adonai Tzevaot, the Lord of hosts. That is the King of glory. Selah. Two other short passages, not quite as grandiose or as poetic. Ralph Waldo Emerson, an early exponent of the transcendentalist American philosophy and ancestor of all liberal religion in America, once wrote, "A person will worship something, have no doubt about that. We may think our tribute is paid in secret in the dark recesses of our hearts, but it will out. That which dominates our imagination and our thoughts will determine our lives and character. Therefore, it behooves us to be careful what we worship, for what we are worshiping, we are becoming." And finally, words of Alice Walker. "Love is not concerned with whom you pray, or where you slept the night you ran away from home. Love is concerned that the beating of your heart should kill no one." You can think on those for a moment.
Thank you.
Got a spot on my suit here. That's what you get for wearing it, right? You got spots on your clothes? Do they bother you? They bother me. In religion, there's a tendency to be worried about spots, getting dirty, sins, and things like that. And you're supposed to pray to get over them, and you're apologizing for them, please. And as you heard in the psalm, those who have clean hands are the only ones allowed up the mountain, kind of thing. I don't want to say those things aren't true, but I think we esteem them wrongly or inaccurately, which is to say we all make mistakes and we all sometimes do bad things, okay? But I'm not sure that the universe is looking down with a kind of, I'm keeping score attitude. So I don't think one needs to pray to be forgiven, to at least that part of the world. In the Jewish tradition, toward the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, Kippur, actually, Kippur means the day of suppression, pushing down oneself. The rule is you can't ask God for forgiveness until you've obtained it from everyone else. I take that to mean in our liberal tradition that if you have a notion of God in your mind, chances are it's one that says God is not keeping score, but it's a cinch the world is, and not your goodness. But every time we omit or commit something that harms someone else, it's like a little hole opens up, or not a spot. That's like, well, if you see I'm getting worn here on the cuff, and it's showing through. I don't want to get rid of it yet, so I think I'll take a little Sharpie and kind of. That's what our time of prayer is. It is to mend inwardly and horizontally. To say, give me the courage to extend a hand of apology, of regret, of care, of forgiveness to someone else that we can reconnect the threads we tear in our errors. The song you're about to sing, that you're about to hear from the choir, a wonderful song, is an aspirational song, that there is somewhere a place for us where we will not be torn apart. But that is not a place over there. It's a place here. And imagining that world is why we exist. Pray with me, will you? Nameless One, Thou who art and art not, Adonai, a word that only means so big I can't say it. I really do screw up from time to time. Probably not more than anyone else, but certainly no less. I need to know, I need to find a way to clean up those spots I make, to mend the tears I create. Most days I don't know how. Most days I'm afraid that if I admit an error, someone will say, yeah, you're bad. Or worst yet, that if I ask for forgiveness, it will be refused. And yet, if we do not take that risk, the spot stains, the threads unravel. This time we give every week is for some hope to find the courage to risk being our flawed and imperfect selves in front of others. In the majesty of this room, before the beauty of its art and sound. We come to find the nerve to be our less beautiful selves, that we may knit a better fabric of greater beauty than we can know. Upon these things, and upon those things that we brought with us, sorrows and joys, losses and victories, we give ourselves now into that prayer that is found only in the presence of silence. So be it, and amen. I may be out of date at this point, but I do still believe that West Side Story is the most perfect example of American music theater. It's virtually an opera, and virtually every note in it is perfect. It's an astonishing piece of work. For those who don't know, the lyricist was Stephen Sondheim,
who is himself a composer. And if you know Stephen Sondheim's lyrics, they're always intricate and profound and witty. Thank you, choir. It was a wonderful prayer you offered. Indeed you did. I am mindful each week as I step into this pulpit to deliver a word of hope, I would hope, I am expecting and challenge that the people who came before us made this place possible, this community possible, made our lives possible. And so I lift up the names of those who have died recently and this year and in years past at this time, that we may honor them with our presence and bid them well as our ancestors. I lift up the names of Gigi Owen and Val Nelson, of Bill Stubbs and Florence Geschwind, of Audrey Turian, of Dick Burke and Jim Starr and Lars Gilson. El Malei Rachamim, God filled with mercy, dwelling in the heaven's heights, bring proper rest beneath the winds of your Shekhinah, your presence, to the souls of our beloved who have gone to their eternal place of rest. May you, who are a source of mercy, shelter them beneath your wings eternally and bind their souls to you and to we the living, that they may rest at peace, that we may be at peace, and let us say, amen. So most of you at this point know that I love very long walks. A week of nothing but walking through a hillside, through a countryside is my idea of heaven, and 2 weeks is twice heaven. And I've had many lovely moments in passing through parts of the world when I could gaze out and take in rolling hills, rivers, and marshes, fields and meadows. Just last May, I made my longest walk ever, 180 miles, from one part of England to the shore, and I ended my last day standing at the top of the white cliffs of Dover and could hope to see just a bit of France in the distance. But I spend more time looking down than looking up, because I have learned, starting in Japan and in England, that if you don't look down, you will certainly fall down. In Japan in particular, the hills were steep and the path was rocky and it rained often, and I had to be careful where I placed my walking stick and where I stepped, and even when I did, did not always succeed. And once on a rainy day on the Scottish border, I climbed a steep set of stone steps literally on my hands and knees for fear of falling off and falling down. Looking down, I have discovered, is just as important as looking up. And yet, looking up is what we're always told to do. Religion in particular loves to look up. How many Christian prayers begin with Heavenly Father, and we know where heaven is? Catholics used to use the Latin words sursum corda, which literally means we lift up our hearts, lifting up. But not just Christians. We heard it in the psalm today. We also heard it, if you look for it, in other cultures. For example, where do the Greek gods live? They live on top of Mount Olympus. One looks up to the mountain, and if you die and you don't get along well, you go down to Hades, which is underground. Those of you who are familiar with Aztec religion and its gruesome ritual of human sacrifice know that they did that in order to offer these beating hearts to the sun god, because that's what he needed to keep shining upon the people of Tenochtitlan. A spiritual in our hymn book says, "Over my head I hear music in the air." Must be a god somewhere, and they meant there. How many of us have heard the hymn or the spiritual, "Swing low, sweet chariot, coming down out of heaven to sweep you back up like Elijah"? On one of my journeys, I climbed a 6,000-step mountain for the Taoist gods who live in the clouds. And on another, I found myself walking to Machu Picchu, which is not down by the sea, but 8,000 feet up. Religion loves up. And of course, those of us who took driver's ed remember being taught that where you look is where you steer, right? So we're supposed to look up spiritually. It's just to look up, because if you don't look up, you won't go in the right direction. And even Jesus, wonderful man that he was, said, no one who puts hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of heaven. In other words, you've got to look outward. Take yourself that away. And of course, Psalm 24 is just filled with look up motifs. You have to ascend the hill, stand in the holy place. People who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false. Lift up your heads, O gates, anthropomorphizing. The gates have to look up, and even the ancient doors. Lift up, 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 up. Now let's talk about the psalm for just a moment or so as an entity in itself. This repetition is not accidental. It turns out to be actually two poems that have been joined over time. And it is very clear by the scholarship that it was meant to be recited as you went up to the temple. Like we do our responsive invocations, it was meant for it to be sung. In fact, the word in Hebrew for psalm, mizmor, means a sung poem. And the reason you repeat yourself, as if you know spirituals as well, it's easier to remember something you repeat. They didn't have hymn books, remember? They were taught by ear, and so you repeat things, and so you repeat them over and over again, and that's part of the way a psalm is structured, to be easily remembered, to be spoken aloud, to be sung. And in this psalm, what happens over and over again is this idea to go up, ascend, go up, lift up, look up. And I've noted already that religion loves this, but religion is not alone. Our culture in general prefers up. What do we call bad people? Lowlifes. Well, those in wealth live the high life. Upper class is always better than lower class. They even live higher up. If you live in a place like New York, where do the rich live? On the top floors. Where do the poor live? Down by the riverside, where it can flood. Even our language prefers up. We build things up, we tear things down. Feeling depressed? Depressed means low. Remember low energy, Jeb? Mm-hmm. Look up, go up, keep up, upward bound, upward and onward, upsy-daisy. Climb the ladder of success, top of the food chain. That's above my pay grade. Up is always good. And yet there I was along the Kumano Kodo in Japan, a narrow pathway sneaking along hillsides. And if I did not look down, I would certainly fall down. And so I don't remember many vistas, but I remember lots of dirt. And I remember also, as I looked down carefully to assure myself of a safe footfall, I saw something blue, strikingly blue, and so I bent down to pick it up. It was as big as a fingernail, but bright, iridescent blue, unnaturally blue, and I thought it must have been something that fell out of someone's pocket, but no. It turned out to be the carapace of a beetle that only lives in Japan, and who knew that I would stumble upon its blue presence, and if I had not looked down, I never would have seen it. Or the next day, when I saw the shell of a tiny land crab splayed out in the dirt, or the frogs that I heard all the time making noises. And so I stopped once and bent down, and underneath the rock there were two glimmering eyes croaking at me. There also was the snake. In other words, when I looked down, I saw a world that I would not have seen had I not looked down. The great British scientist Alexander Fleming, the one who gave us penicillin, his wisdom was in recognizing his own imperfection. He wrote, "One sometimes finds what one is not looking for." And this is the peril of looking up. When we look up, we're looking for something, but we may not see everything. We may overlook that which is worth seeing. There is a world right here at our feet with blue beetles and inland crabs and so much more. I was hiking to Santiago, one of my fortunate years, not the long campus, not the long hike. I didn't have 4 weeks, I had 1 week. So I was coming from the north to the south, going through an enclosed bower-like forest, and down in the moist, wet area, I saw a whole crowd of mushrooms with red tops and white spots that looked like a place where gnomes and fairies would come together and congregate. They weren't there that day, but I wouldn't have been surprised if they had turned up later. But only had I looked beyond, I would have missed this accumulation of life. I've said, like I said, snakes and bugs. And of course, here at home, I can only realize that the rabbits have been across my lawn if I see their tracks in the snow in the morning. How much of life, of the world, have you and I missed by pointing ourselves upward and onward? And when we do go upward and onward, do we just push things out of the way to get to our goal? Remember what John Lennon said? He paraphrased someone else. Life is what happens while you're busy making other plans. Looking up is good. Goals are great. But today is as real as the next day you're going for. Let's remember that Jesus also said that the kingdom of God was at hand. Whatever that means, he was saying, it's not over there, it's right here. Now. And the word at hand is a physical word. It's next to you. It's at your hand. No further away than you can reach. Earlier this week, a few folks gathered to commemorate and celebrate the life of one of our members, Gene Kruger. Now, I lift this up because as I'm creating this sermon in my head later in the week, my own words came back to me as being useful here, and I don't like quoting myself, but they seem to stick with me. However much we resist, I told them, nothing can untwist the universe when life turns into death. We can only pause and witness and remember. And I think that pausing, that witnessing, that remembering is something we forget to do in our headlong rush to get to wherever that place up there is. Do not mistake this as counsel to stop and smell the roses. That is not what I'm saying. I mean to say that, again, the wisdom of Jesus is to take him seriously, that the kingdom of God, whatever that means, the sacred, the precious, the ultimate, is not over there at all any more than it is right here, right now. And if we don't see it and grab it, it will not be there. God, whatever God is, well, let's call it the truly real, the really true, is not up a hill, not behind a gate, not within a temple, not above the clouds, not somewhere other than here. It is right here and right now. And if we stumble over it as if there is something better to have, we are passing over that which is most sacred to get to something that is less than that. Like the fabled animal that saw the reflection of itself in the mirror holding the meal and dropped it to get the other one, we have what we need present today. Now, that sounds all mystical and spiritual and kind of om-like, and maybe we should all become Zen and things, but actually I'm counseling a very difficult ethical practice. Every Sunday, people without homes come and rest in our mezzanine as they come to get warm, to have a cup of coffee, grab a nap. That bothers some of us. And I understand. And we should be bothered not by them, but by our own sense of being bothered. Why are we bothered? The kingdom of God is at hand. If we take that seriously, that which is truly real and really true is everywhere, is everything and is everyone, what are we troubled about? that should be on our minds every Sunday. That should be. It's on my mind every Sunday. And if I'm troubling your mind right now, good. Because the kingdom of God is like the troubling of the waters in the tale of the paralytic by the pool of Bethesda. If we don't trouble the waters of our complacency, we will come to think that tomorrow is the better day, not today. Now, I'll admit, to be human is to have our eyes on the far horizon, on the heavens, but it's also to have our feet on this ground right here. To be human is to imagine tomorrow, to imagine a better day and a better world, and to be human is to be in this world today, at this moment, imperfect as it is. We are built to be in both places at the same time, and like magnets with a north and a south pole, we can no more become human by cutting off one than we can cut off the other. We will have to dream of the future, we will have to aspire, and yet we must live in this world, or we must live here now, and we know it. And religion, spirituality, whatever that is the moment when those two poles come close enough that a little spark flies between them like static electricity and we wake up a little more than we did before. A few days ago, I went down to Battle Creek. It's the first time I've been there in person, though I've been here for 13 years. And I remember it as the place to which I sent all my box tops as a child. I did not remember that it was also the last and long-term home of Sojourner Truth, whose immense statue stands right in the corner there, and the words that you heard today are inscribed there in other places. I really like the one at the top of our order of worship. Didn't you like that one a lot? I may not be able to read words, but I can read men. Oh, to have that wisdom. She said a lot more than the things we have heard, and here's another passage I found that helped to shape my thoughts this morning. She said, "Those are the same stars, and that is the same moon that look down upon your brothers and sisters, which they see as they look up at them, though they are ever so far away from us and each other." In my studies this week, I read that in youth we look up at the stars wondering how we can get to them, and in age we look up at the stars and wonder how they think of us. Up and down, down and up, dreaming and living, living and dreaming, every one of us caught in the aspiration to become something we have not become and to be the person we are. And that dilemma is what makes us human beings. An incompleteness, an imperfection, an inability to become what we want, but a desire to grow. And as Sojourner Truth pointed out, that is what makes us connected to each other. Believe it or not, everyone on the planet at some level wants to become something. For some, it'll be, I want to become rich. I want to become famous. For others, is I want to be warm. I want to be safe. But that longing, the longing part, is what matters. Everyone wishes to go up. Everyone must stand on the ground, and that is what it means to be human. And that, ultimately, is what makes us all one people. So as we enter into the world to come, meaning tomorrow, the question we should take out the door with us today is to find in our hearts and our minds the wisdom to see that every one of us has a dream that looks up, and every one of us has a path that requires that we look down. And perhaps as we do, we will look around and find others on the way and take joy and comfort in traveling together. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be found true in thy sight, thou who art my rock and my Redeemer. Now, as the choir comes up, because we need their help today, I'm going to remind you that while Sojourner Truth was an enslaved person, she was an enslaved person in New York State before slavery was abolished. So unlike many of the other enslaved people in the United States, she did not have to flee from slavery the way many others did, but many of them did, coming up from the South. And they were not lettered, they did not know how to read, they could not talk to people as they went for fear of being turned in. They traveled at night so they wouldn't be seen. So how did they find their way? The North Star. They were told to follow the drinking gourd, the Big Dipper, which pointed to the North Star. And if you went that way, you would find freedom. And that's where this spiritual comes from. To follow the drinking gourd is to go toward freedom. And isn't that what we're all still trying to do? So this song, as we have others, is one where we share and we listen. And so I'm wondering, Ms. Marilyn, should the choir lead us through this, go through it so we can all get used to it? Why don't we do that, and then we'll join them the second time around, shall we? Thank you so much. I think you'll find it in your hymn book as number, I can't remember. 152, I'm told. Yes, that's it. Let's listen, then we'll join them. Courage of the early morning's dawn and the strength of the eternal hills and the peace of evening's ending and the love which is the only wise God be true, be present with us now and every day, because this and every day is a day which the Lord has made. Let us ever rejoice and be glad in it. Amen and amen.